I'm Paul Bozinski. I'm the chair of the Global Studies Department here at SUNY Orange. Perhaps some of you are wondering, clearly some of you know, but for those of you who don't, Global Studies is the areas of history, political science, economics, and foreign languages. 10 full-time faculty, a few of them here this evening. So welcome. This is the first in our series of what we're calling the Culture Wars. Now let me start with this before I even introduce our panelists. Ripped literally from the pages of today's Times Herald Record, it's a letter to the editor on the opinion page by a gentleman named John Habensberger of New Paltz, Abuse of Constitution, and he cites the First Amendment, Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion, the Establishment Clause, and then he talks about the Obama administration's attempt to force any religion to go against its core beliefs violates both the letter and spirit of this amendment, and he goes on to explain why he feels this latest abortion policy of the president is a violation. And then the letter ends, President Obama seems to think he can violate the Constitution if what he's doing is for the greater good. Unfortunately, benevolent tyranny is still tyranny, and those who think this is okay won't be so happy. When a president they don't agree with wields the same power, while not a Catholic, I still find this abuse of power very troubling. Okay, I get the point that someone would disagree with a public policy of the President of the United States of America, and clearly we're all within our rights, and maybe it ought to even be a social obligation occasionally to do so. But then to make the leap to this being a tyrannical abuse of power on the part of the President of the United States of America, to me that smacks of the classic non sequitur, and that's really what we're talking about when we're discussing the culture wars. So let me officially welcome all of you this evening. This is the first of eight, you know what we're calling these, Fireside Lounge Chats. So you're first asking, where's the fireplace? Where's the lounge? Will this be a chat? Well, perhaps not in the classic sense of sitting in a coffee bar chatting, but we certainly hope to discuss amongst the panelists here this evening and all of you in the audience some very important and to some extent some very troubling points about how we talk to each other politically in the United States today and so much of the rancor and the heated passion we hear in social, political, and cultural discourse. Anyway, the title is meant to conjure up the great images of Franklin Roosevelt and his fireside chats. And in fact, the FDR Presidential Library and Museum is involved in our project here. And two of the events we'll be holding this spring will be over in Hyde Park at the FDR Presidential Museum. So I know that Orange Community College is very pleased to be partnered with them. So this is our series on civility and democracy. And I guess I should start by saying that apparently the major candidates running for president, Gingrich, Romney, Santorum, and Obama, have heard about these panels, have all taken a pledge to be nicer to each other in the presidential primaries in the looming general election. So already we've spread our, well, seriously, we up here, I think I speak for the four of us, labor under no special illusions. Our goal is very simple in this panel and the seven that'll be coming up in this spring semester. It's to talk with you, the audience, about this poisonous, not always, but often and far too frequently poisonous tone that our political and public discourse takes in the United States of America today. We want to figure out why the tone of discourse between the left and the right, liberals and conservatives, Republicans and Democrats, and many others, frankly, has become so harsh, in particular in how we discourse in public campaigns. We're doing this in a presidential election year, and there's a reason for that. When we see so much of this awful rancor and backbiting between Republicans and Democrats, it seems as if the more important the election, the more the heat is turned up in that discourse. So basically, I see these series of panels on civility and democracy about two main themes. We're going to talk about conflict between the left and the right, and we're going to try and talk about solutions which will involve some resolution, at least in our own minds, of these conflicts, okay? So we've got three themes that we'll be following in these eight panels here, New Paltz, our Middletown campus, and as I said, over in Hyde Park in the FDR Museum. The first is tonight's theme, and we'll be talking specifically to the issues of what, I've got the book, the term culture wars was in fact first coined in the early 1990s by a political scientist, James Hunter, in his book, The Culture Wars, The Struggle to Define America. And it is a book that literally tries to make sense of the battles in this country over family, family values, art. Boy, I remember that Mapplethorpe thing a few years ago. Education, law, politics, and the media. So we're going to talk about the culture wars between the left and the right. We need historical context as well. So two of these panels are going to be on civil rights, and we're going to talk about racial discourse too, specifically racial fault lines between blacks and whites in the post-World War II era. And then we will take you back to World War II and beyond, and we will look at the FDR presidency. We will find perhaps that the culture wars are nothing new, and that the kind of uncivil discourse which occurred between Roosevelt when he first ran for president in 1932 and last was elected to office in 1944 were attacks that came both from members of his own party and from the left. For them, Franklin Roosevelt wasn't socialist enough. And many attacks, of course, came from the right, from right-wing Republicans, as well as the Catholic right. So we'll talk about the culture wars, we'll talk about civil rights and the FDR presidency. So let me introduce our panel next, because we've got some very good folks with us this evening, and we'll cut right to the chase and tell you a little bit about them. I am Paul Baczynski. I've been at Orange Community for 10 years, chaired the Department of Global Studies for the last five. I have 25 years in the profession. I've been teaching political science in colleges and universities since the late 1980s. I'm a product of SUNY, graduate work at the University of Buffalo. Had an opportunity to teach at New Paltz. I also taught at a neoconservative bastion in the Midwest at Hillsdale College in the early 1990s. That was a very interesting experience for me, both professionally and personally. I was in the Kansas State University system, and as I said, I came to Orange in 2001. I'm obviously very interested in the questions we'll be raising in these series of panels on civility and democracy, specifically from the perspective of being a practicing political scientist. We also have, to my right, Alice Andrews. Alice has her MA and BA from Columbia University. She is the founder and editor of Evolutionary Review. She's a lecturer in psychology at SUNY New Paltz since 2004. She's also taught, has experience teaching at two-year colleges at SUNY Dutchess, just across the Hudson River here. She, I guess would be fair to say, considers herself an active and an activist and is very active in a number of social and environmental causes throughout the Hudson Valley, environmental conservation, pesticide action. There was a long, long list of things that Alice has been involved in the New Paltz area in particular, where she's currently working. Richard Mayfield, at the opposite end, is Director of Operations and Acting Information Technology Commissioner for Orange County. Mr. Mayfield brings a world of political experience. He's worked for Orange County for 7 years. He's worked for 4 years in the New York State Assembly, 12 years in a number of roles for our former U.S. Congressman Ben Gilman. You know, SUNY Orange is now the official repository of Congressman Gilman's papers and effects from his 30 years in Washington, D.C. And in the middle, I don't know if politically he's in the middle, but he's in the middle here tonight, is Robert Sassy. He is the department chair of social studies at Valley Central High School. He has 27 years in himself, a veteran truly of his post in the public school system. He's an adjunct professor as well in our Department of Global Studies. Coordinates as well the youth program, a youth and government program for Orange County BOCES, former Orange County legislator, former chair of the Middletown Republican Party, a lot of political experience between Rich Mayfield and Robert Sassy. Okay, so here we go. As we envisioned this panel when we wrote the grant for the New York Council for the Humanities, and I should publicly thank the New York Council for sponsoring this and the seven other panels that we'll be putting on between now and May 2nd. What we had thought we wanted to do is talk about the issue of civil or truly uncivil discourse in a presidential and congressional election year. We thought it was a very timely thing to do that. And basically, that's what we're going to discuss here tonight, the tensions between liberals and conservatives, or the left and the right, however you choose to label these divisions. I guess I should say this. We're all aware, I think, of the culture wars, at least superficially, because the media has occasionally, for purely entertaining reasons, whether we're listening to Rush Limbaugh driving home in the car, or Bill O'Reilly, or Ann Coulter, Al Franken, I think, is another media figure in the culture wars, now a United States senator from Minnesota. You think Michael Moore and the various documentaries that Moore has put out. They do present a very engaging picture of the culture wars, and sometimes entertaining. But I wonder if sometimes, and we'll talk a little bit about the media here, if they don't throw gasoline or fuel on the fire of this discord between the left and the right in particular, okay? But what good does it do? For example, in the 4 years now nearly that he's been president, the right has labeled Barack Obama not a natural-born citizen of the United States, hence unable to serve the country. They've labeled him a Muslim when all evidence to the contrary suggests he is a practicing Christian. The president of the United States the last 48 months has variously been referred to as a socialist, a communist, a neo-Nazi, and much worse, both in the public press and in our political and public discourse. Conversely, his predecessor, George Bush, in the 8 years he was president, was branded a racist, a thinly concealed homophobe. Former President Bush was accused of having helped mastermind the 9/11 attacks. Those on the left claimed that Bush wanted to start two wars in the Middle East and avenge his father. This in spite of the evidence of the 9,000-page report of the 9/11 Commission saying there was no evidence to suggest there was a domestic connection to the terror attacks of September 11, 2001. So that's what I think we want to get at. I've got a number of questions here where hopefully the panel will help me talk a little bit about some of the historical roots of the culture wars between the left and the right. I wonder if it makes any sense to try and apportion blame, whether the blame comes from the public or whether the blame should be apportioned to the media or the major political parties themselves for this uncivil discourse. We want to talk about if the conflict is inevitable today or if somehow it's part of larger cycles and it tends to ebb and flow from one generation to the next. But what I wanted to do is just listen for a little bit now. I'd like the members of our panel perhaps to say a few things at the outset that will give us a sense of their perspective about the culture wars between the left and the right, and about these larger issues of civility and discourse in public life in the United States today. When we've done that, I'm going to pose some specific questions to our group. But what the New York Council asked us to do is to try and have a diverse panel and a diverse audience. I think we do have a diverse audience out there today. So very quickly, we want to open it up to questions from all of you as well. Questions or comments, I'd simply ask you to keep your comments as direct and to the point as you possibly can. And if you have questions, please ask them clearly. And if you want to direct them to a particular member of the panel or the panel in its entirety, then feel free to do either. Why don't I have Rich Mayfield start out? Rich comes to us with a lot of experience in local government and local politics, and I know he has a few things he'd like to say from his point of view about the culture wars.
Well, thank you, Paul. That was a very nice introduction, much nicer than I got 2 weeks ago at a veterans event. They said we're now for the latest dope from Goshen, Rich Mayfield. Of course, veterans event, those of you with blonde hair know dope was information, not being sarcastic or calling me. I will have to tell you, I'm that little boy that your mother warned you about. Well, not that little boy, the other little boy. I am a professional politician. I have done it for 21 years. I have paid my mortgage, my bills. All of that has been paid for by being a professional politician. And And I know that in 10 years, that tape is going to resurface if I were to ever run for election. It will haunt me.
Yeah.
But I am very proud to say I have made my living as a politician. And why would I say that? It almost seems as if in America, particularly now, if you listen to any of the current candidates, they trip all over themselves. I'm an outsider. I know absolutely nothing about the process. I am the most ignorant candidate in the room. And they truly do and espouse that, and we seem to run after the most incompetent person for elective office. And I think that leads me to a second point, is we are then stunned at the outcome that we get. You understand what I'm saying? We run after these people and then are stunned at the government we get. So I'll pose a question to you. Do you get the government that you pay for? Do you get the government that you deserve? I suspect if you were honest with yourselves, you would admit we all get the government we deserve. We don't get the government that we pay for, but we get the government that we deserve. So, at the local level, particularly, and I work for the County of Orange, I'm assuming most of you are Orange County residents and taxpayers, it kind of filters down. Washington sneezes, Albany gets a cold, and then we at the local level get double pneumonia, because in New York, we are the service arm and provider for most of the social programs that the folks in Washington and Albany come up with. So really, when you're coming into a local office and we have to tell you, I would like to give you this particular benefit, but you're $2 over, we bear the brunt of your anger or the constituents' confusion as to why the people, the great fathers in Albany, would come up with some of these income limitations. So it's a very challenging time for local government. If you take the county budget and make it a dollar bill, 24 cents out of that dollar bill is all we run county government on. The rest is mandated services. We have absolutely no control over how they're spent. So roads, bridges, union contracts, this for your local officials, and again, most of these folks, when they get involved in local government, are shopkeepers. They're, maybe we're fortunate enough, they'll be teachers, nurses, you know, they're part-timers. So my point in saying it's a very difficult time for them, I understand as taxpayers sometimes we get a little frustrated with them, but you know, maybe when you go to your next town board meeting and you get ready to say, you know, supervisor, you're a big jerk. They're really not. They're folks just like you. They're your neighbors. They have the same desires to serve their community as you do. And I'll close with this. Words matter. And I think as we go through this panel this evening, you'll see in some of the words that come out of Washington and Albany and local folks, just how they're said is going to really make a tremendous impact on what you hear. I'll stop with that.
Thank you, Rich. Let me follow up right away. So really, I think what you're saying to summarize is that county government is the front line in terms of the taxpayers. You provide so many services, but with fewer and fewer resources. The mandates trickle down inevitably from Washington, D.C., and from Albany as well, of course, in the other 49 states, but frequently you struggle with the resources. What about the tone? Has the tone changed in political discourse at the local level as well? Do you think that what we're seeing in the national media and some of the division has trickled down to Orange County, or do you feel that it's still possible for people on the left and the right, for Republicans and Democrats, to find some sort of common ground on issues that really matter to the taxpayers of Orange County, because this is truly where the rubber meets the road?
I think in Orange County, we're fortunate that, by and large, the vast majority of issues that come before the county legislature are voted on in a responsible manner. It's
and you could take this into Washington, the suspension calendars, the vast majority of what goes through in suspension calendars is non-controversial, and it you know, it goes through with a quick, you know, a long roll, short roll, whatever the term might happen to be at the various organizations you're working with. But, you know, it's the really gritty ones. And there's you're never going to get past the desire for power. One side has it, the other side doesn't, and they're always going to use that as a leverage if they think there's an issue that, you know, you're particularly upset about. You know, that's part of the process. It's a greasy pole. Mm-hmm. But by and large, and I think you would find this in many, many of your local government, they're able to look past it. They work together. They reach across the aisle and try to get things accomplished. Because if they don't, where are we going to go with it? I mean, Washington, they can send it down to the states. The states can send it down to us. Well, we're it. We can't pass the buck any further. So we normally have to figure out a way to make it work.
One way or another.
Sure. Thanks, Rich. How about Rob Sassy next? Let's hear from Robert, his take on this.
Thank you, Paul. Good evening, everybody. It's nice to see a nice gathering here tonight. A good politician always welcomes a crowd, Richard. You forgot that rule, first rule. I'm excited to be here. When Paul, my department chair, called me a while back in the summer, forming this panel, I thought it would be a great idea, and as we got closer to this night, I really got more and more excited to be here. I've done a lot of things in my life. One thing that I've done pretty much my whole life as a young adult to the present is to follow politics. And my degree is in political science. I teach government and history. I've served as a legislator. I'm currently serving as a town board in Orange County as well, in the town of Crawford where I live, which is, you know, where Pine Bush is, that's the outermost area there. It's interesting, people say, well, why would you get back in that mess? I mean, you can't win. You can win, and Richard said it quite eloquently that we are, as Paul Buzinski said, we're in a huge cultural divide right now where people are angry, they're bitter, and the things that I do in my life range from last night going to a school board budget meeting where people there were there with the old, you know, pickaxe and a hammer, and they're attacking the superintendent and they're angry and they're bitter, to tonight being here is more civil, to tomorrow night a town board meeting where people are upset about a Buddhist temple that's being proposed out in the town of Crawford, and they too will come out angry and bitter. And as Richard said, we're all the same residents, we're all the same people. Politics has always been a nasty game. You go back in history, incivility is nothing new. Those of you that know history, certainly Paul and members of the Global Studies Department, going back in time, it's always been there. And I remember, you know, finally reading the McCullough book, John Adams, and all the shenanigans and the backstabbing and backbiting that went on behind the scenes back in the 1700s. Mm-hmm. It's still there. It's always been there, but it's magnified today. And the media, which is a competitive business, operates 24/7, certainly with the internet, with our smartphones. So, you know, the President of the United States, you know, has a misstep. He slips. He was out in California, I believe, last night. He started singing some jazz tunes, and whoop, they pounce on him. Well, what? And it's just absolutely amazing what's happened. Class warfare, cultural war, but it's being magnified. Combine that with a sluggish economy and you know, an ever-changing and evolving culture in the United States, whether it be gay marriage, an issue like that, legalization of marijuana, it gets people fired up, it gets them angry. So there's been a polarization between the Democrats and the liberal faction of the Democratic Party and the Republicans and the conservative side. And I'm watching, you know, it's quite fascinating to see the four Republican challengers, Romney, Santorum, Gingrich, and Paul, slug it out. And that's indicative of what's going on in our country, because no one really likes those four candidates on the Republican side. And they're bouncing all over. And then there's President Obama, and he's got his detractors. It's sad. It's absolutely sad. People, they don't talk to each other anymore. And they certainly don't listen. They yell and talk is what they're doing. And when it comes to politics and why people get so disenchanted with Washington is because of all the talking and the screaming and the finger pointing and the low blows. And that's sad. And when you look at the approval ratings of Congress, they're the paltry 10, 11% at best right now. Why? Because Americans have had it. And why have they had it? They're tired of listening to the garbage. They want to see action.
Thank you. Ellis?
It's interesting. So my background, I'm not a politician, I'm not a cultural critic, I'm not a political scientist. I do evolutionary psychology. I'm interested in using evolutionary theory and I apply it to the human mind and human behavior. And so I have a very different kind of take on all of this. But what's funny is that everything you said I agree with. I use an evolutionary lens to understand what you're talking about in a certain sense, or that's how I, but it basically comes out the same. So, for example, my understanding of this process where we sort of arrived at in terms of all of this, I sort of see generations moving in a sort of more open kind of thing. So, you know, my daughter, she's a teenager. She's a lot more open than I was as a teenager, with her friends even. And, you know, that can be, you can look back generation to generation, and you can see that there's a kind of openness with each successive generation. And I think that our technology sort of, it kind of reflects that. It's sort of part of it, the technology and the sort of this meme of openness and sort of communication. So the same, just like you're talking about with the internet, we've got, you know, basically constant communication, constant updating of information, constant. And so what happens is these issues, everybody wants to take care of everybody else. That's what people on the right and people on the left, they all want to take care of one another, but some of the people, liberals, have a different sense of who they want to take care of, and conservatives have another sense of who they want to take care of. But they all have this idea of wanting to take care of, and how do we do that? And so, where was I going with this? So basically, what I'm interested in looking at is using this evolutionary theory to get at sort of fixing this incivility. And one of the ways that we can do it is natural selection has basically formed our minds. We are the products of natural selection, our minds and our behavior, in my opinion. We are the products of natural selection. And within evolutionary theory, there's something called group selection. So basically the idea is that, you know, sometimes people on the right, conservatives, will say things like, oh, it's just, you know, it's all about survival, it's all about the individual. But in fact, multi-level selectionist theorists, these evolutionists who believe that selection and evolution took place at the group level. So what that means is that, you know, 50,000, 100,000, you know, even 250,000 years ago, natural selection was taking place at the group level, so that groups were competing with other groups. What that means is that we have both, that we have within us a deep need to care about the group and the group's survival. And there's a social psychologist named John Haidt, who's got a book coming out in March. And what he says is that we've got 90% chimp brain and 10% bee brain, or beehive brain. And the idea is that we both care about ourselves and our individuals, and ourselves at the individual level and our genetic level. We care about our offspring, and we care about our kin, and we care about ourselves. But in fact, there's a part of us that very much, and this won't surprise anybody here probably, cares about the group. beyond ourself, like a selfless kind of thing. And I think what is important is to try to figure out how to tap into that groupish beehive part of ourselves. If we can do that, then we can figure out a way to get beyond this incivility. And I think, I guess when you had mentioned this thing about, and I was saying this evolutionary idea, you know, this openness, the technology, the internet, the sort of, we've always had, just like you said, we've always had this, you know, the infighting and in-group and out-group, and it's called monkey politics. We've done it for thousands and thousands of generations. This is our legacy. We came, this is who we are. But it doesn't mean that we can't figure out a way to sort of transcend it. And I think that there's various ways we can tap into getting beyond sort of the vitriol. And I think that, well, I guess we're going to be talking about that later.
Yeah.
I shouldn't. But basically, I want to use this evolutionary lens to apply, you know, to figure out what's going on here. And I think, So,
great.
That's what we're trying to do.
Speaking of evolutionary psychology, now there is a theory circulating about the last 10 years that suggests that it may be the case that we are hardwired to some extent to lean towards the left or right, and be either, you've heard this, be either socially conservative or liberal.
Sure, yeah. And I was going to actually mention, there's been a couple of different theories, and this would be more neuroscientific, not necessarily evolutionary, but they just did a study, they found that the liberal brain, this area of, it's like right in the center of your brain in front, but not the prefrontal cortex, it's an area called the anterior cingulate cortex. It's involved, it wraps around the corpus callosum, and it basically is involved with things like decision making and emotion and empathy, which is something I want to maybe talk about later. They have found that liberals actually have a larger anterior cingulate cortex. Conversely, conservatives, they looked at the brains of conservatives and they found that their amygdala, the area that is, you know, when you look in an MRI, you know, the amygdala, it's the fear area. And so that's very interesting.
But that's larger in conservatives.
So now the question is always nature versus nurture, right? Are you born with a larger anterior cingulate cortex or a larger amygdala? You know, or does experience make it larger? So we don't know the answers, and we probably won't for a while, but it certainly is interesting. And I often think that sometimes some of these fights, and this is going to sound very provocative, but
please provoke.
But I sometimes think that some of these fights are about our genes. I sometimes think that if the left and the right, if they really do have these areas of different brain areas, what are they really fighting for? They're really fighting for some kind of survival, because they have such different ways of thinking. And this guy, John Haidt, this social psychologist, he has this idea of these six moral foundations, and he thinks that they're all, that liberals and conservatives sort of amplify different moral foundations. So for example, one of the dichotomies in the six foundations is care versus harm. So liberals are very interested in this dichotomy of care versus harm, whereas according to John Haidt, who's looked at all of this information, conservatives are less, not that they don't care about care versus harm, but they're not as interested as liberals, whereas, for example, a conservative might be interested in something like authority versus subversiveness, whereas a liberal might not be that interested. Now, those things could be somewhat heritable. They could be somehow connected to genes, not like one gene, but many genes. And so at bottom, I sometimes wonder if we're battling something much more beyond ideas and values, and we're really battling who survives, which is pretty.
It's fascinating, of course. And then we are not going to solve the question today of the role of nature versus culture in terms of forming our political opinions and attitudes. But I think it's fascinating that there is an entire wing of both social and natural scientists who are looking at the evolutionary psychology behind the culture wars and are looking at these issues, what we would consider social or political issues, from the perspective of modern neuroscience as well. So let me throw some questions out to you good folks next. And here's one that I'm very interested in. Do you think there are long-term harmful effects of the culture wars on U.S. democracy? Do we see a lack of support and interest in politics and political processes today from voters or from concerned citizens? Has this rancor, this fighting on the left and the right got so bad that at some level it's turned off an enormous segment of the population and is creating its own negative feedback loop? And if so, what do we do about that? We don't simply tell the Republicans, Democrats in Washington or Albany or in Sacramento, it's a big sandbox, kids, and you all have to learn how to play nicely in it together. Certainly the solution to the problem isn't that easy. And yet the more they fight, the more the media magnifies that conflict, the more problematic it makes the very sense of what it means to be a functional and healthy participatory democracy. Is that the case, this negative feedback loop? Let's talk about that a little bit and the impact, the potentially broader impact the culture wars are having on our political culture and on the citizens' sense of their democracy and their relationship to it.
Well, I definitely, when we get 50% voter turnout for a presidential election year and we consider that good, it's pretty sad. So where are the other 50%? They're turned off, the negativity, that's where it's hurting democracy, Paul. I think it's just that people are so angry and so bitter. They view all politicians as liars and cheaters. Oh, they all, that's all they do is they cheat, they
all
lie,
corrupt,
they cheat and steal. They're all corrupt. And the media, I am not a fan of the media. It does have a role, certainly, to bring us the news, and we want them to bring us the news. But they focus on things that are, kind of reminds me when I was a kid and I bring my report card home. And I was a pretty good student, except for math. That's why I teach history. And my mother inevitably would pick out the C that I got in math. Why'd you get a C? Look at that, it's horrible. And it would drive me nuts. But I think as a society, as a culture, we focus on the negativity. As you said before, are we getting the government we paid for or the one that we deserve, or however you had phrased it, Richard? And it seems that as much as the media has become negative, we actually like that in a twisted way. We like that.
Because conflict sells. Because
it sells.
But the news today is the Republicans and Democrats fought over nothing and agreed on everything.
Right.
And, boy, you better go watch something else.
Right.
But
right.
As soon as you say that Newt Gingrich bit Rick Santorum in the neck at a joint campaign event,
right,
all of a sudden the media are all over that because conflict is sexy.
Right.
Conflict is what people tune into. It just seems so innate in some aspect of the American character or culture.
Right, or the Anthony Weiner situation, former Governor Spitzer. What they did was not right, but years ago, the media outlets wouldn't have been able to jump on that and bring it to us on a smartphone where we could watch it. Now we can, and people get disgusted, they get angry, and apathetic. I just don't care. So in terms of a true democracy, when you have less and less people participating in the system, that's dangerous. That's dangerous on both sides, whichever way it could go. It's not in the middle. Years ago, there was compromise. Today, there's such a great polarization, in my opinion, between the two parties and their ideologies that they're firmly entrenched in their corners. There's no middle ground. Democrats that try to vote with Republicans, we have the term blue dog, you know, they're kind of choked by their party, like, you better not, you better stay with us. Same thing with Republicans that might drift towards the middle or towards the left. They're you know, castrated behind the scenes. So it's really, and myself, I mean, I watch this stuff, I listen to it, but there's so much hatred and so much anger and so much vile, and it's not a healthy situation. So people, you know, maybe they're right just to say, look, I just don't want to listen to it.
I heard this, and I don't remember where, but I'll throw it out at any rate. It said that more Americans select where they'll live, who they'll live with today by political or social ideology than by race or sex or income. It seems amazing, but then look at the divisions in red and blue states today.
Yeah,
in fact, I love much about Kansas, and I taught in Western Kansas for 10 years, but I just got tired of being the token liberal in one of the red states. And as a result of that, I wanted to move back to New York State. I wanted to live in a social and political culture where I don't want to be around people that all think the same or believe the same way that I do. Certainly, I don't want that kind of monotheism or whatever you want to call it. But I just felt uncomfortable where I was, and I voted with my feet. And we know that millions of Americans do this in this generation. Maybe we're seeing some of the fallout of the 60s generation and their social attitudes and views and norms versus the subsequent Reagan generation and the rise of neoconservatives reacting to that 60s rebellion. And I want to talk about that a little bit. But I do want to hear a little more from Rich Mayfield.
So let me throw one thing out to you. It's another problem, and you probably wouldn't think of it, but in a former life, one of my jobs was candidate recruitment. And just what you're talking about, I would sit there, and hard to fathom, but it really, you would sit there and you would go through lists of people who you would think would make a qualified, competent candidate for elective office. And I could spend weeks calling people, interviewing, begging, please, would you run for office? And because of the lack of respect by the citizenry, the inter-party warfares, the embarrassment, I'll put my taxes out on it, I don't want them to find out that, you know, I was on Lover's Lane with Susie Q 40 years ago, and that'll come back to haunt me, and my wife will. The things that people have to sacrifice to run for political office, it's absolutely ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And when you look at the current crop of candidates, and I'm not trying to be critical, I'm just asking you to think critically. If this is the best that we can do, well, maybe it is, but is this the best that we can do? Why don't some of you run for political office? Any consultant worth their salt, and this is, they'll charge you $10,000 for this piece of information,
yeah.
I'll give it to you for free. What's the number one reason why someone will vote for you? The number one reason why someone will vote for you as opposed to him. Does anybody know? Take a guess.
The way you look.
No. You ask them to. That's it. You ask them to vote for you. You hit their door, you sent them a piece of mail, you called them, you saw them at the post office and said, hi, I'm Rob Sassy, I'm running for town council, can I count on your support? Number one reason. And then there are other factors that go on down the line, and that I would have to charge you for.
So one additional bit of negative fallout from the discord between the left and the right is we don't get the best people running for public office. You know, there's been a tremendous criticism of the American presidency over the last generation or more and the kinds of candidates that the process produces. Well, it's not only the process, but it's how these candidates are vetted, and it's the social and political environment that they are running or in many cases choosing not to run within. So in the long run, we may be shooting ourselves in the foot because of the culture wars, because of the very folks we need to be leading the nation at this point in time are not willing to do so because they're just not willing to put up with the crap that so much of it calls for. Alice?
Yeah, it's funny because people have asked me, I live in New Paltz, and I've lived there since 1999, and for years people will come up to me, because I'm active in the community, and they'll say, Alice, will you run for school board, or Alice, will you run for town council, And they stopped asking me because I always said no. And the reason I always said no was because it's just too difficult. I mean, and that sounds terrible, but too difficult especially for me, and I'll explain why I think that. But there are, you know, evolutionary psychologists talk about a universal human nature. There's certain things about animals and certain things about humans that have a kind of essence, that have an essential core, a universal human nature. But beyond that, then there's something we call individual variation or individual differences. And within this human nature, there's a continuum. And there's this, in psychology, there's this construct. It's got a silly name. It's called highly sensitive person. If anybody ever told you when you were growing up that you were too sensitive, you might, in fact, be a highly sensitive person. I see somebody laughing, though. And it may, in fact, have sort of genetic correlates and, you know, neural correlates. It may be related to your brain. 15 to 20% of people, at least in this country, as far as I know, are highly sensitive people, and I'm one of them. I score like 27 out of 27 on the thing. It makes it very difficult for me to sit here in front of everybody because I'm highly sensitive. I'm sensitive to sights and sounds and being in front of people and all that stuff. But so anyway, the idea is that these types of people may be great for being, you know, doing the kinds of things that we need to, you know, do.
Public service.
Right, yeah. But, you know, like, there's just no way that I would ever do it. Because I, you know, even I had created this Facebook page in my town, in my village, just for the town, just to create information to get out, like when we had Hurricane, when we had Irene, and just various things. And just updating with information. We had something terrible happen the other day to a young woman at SUNY walking down Plattekill. That's the kind of thing where I just, you know, shot that information onto the Facebook page. Where was I going with this? I can't remember. But anyway,
so, what you're saying,
yeah,
is it's probably not an encouraging environment for a highly sensitive person to run for
exactly
office
what
today.
I was, right, yeah. And that page isn't even, because people get nasty on that page,
yeah,
and it makes me and some of my friends want to, you know, you were talking about, you know, this idea of listening and, you know, it makes me not to contribute. It makes me want to, you know, put my fingers in my ears because I can't take, you know, the sort of, again, the vitriol, the sort of nastiness for really no reason.
Well, they'd say that to get into politics, you have to have a thick skin, or you don't take the issues personally or take them to heart.
That's
but
right.
We're all human beings.
Right.
There's only so much that you can take from the media or take from the opposing party before finally you ask yourself, or your wife or your children, your family asks you, this just isn't worth it. It isn't worth it to me. It isn't worth it to putting my family through this. I mean, aren't we seeing much more of this? And how thick a skin, you know, you shouldn't have to be a rhinoceros to run for public office in Orange County today, or in Albany, or Washington, D.C. You should have to assume that you're going to put up with some reasonable BS at times, or valid comments from the public. But beyond that, the what is expected of our politicians and our public officials today maybe goes beyond the pale, you know, maybe far beyond that. And that brings me to a follow-up, and we're going to get to the audience just a moment here. Let me ask just a few more questions directly to our panelists. What's the role of the press in this? We've talked a little bit about it. Is the media liberal and biased? Haven't we heard that now for 20 or 30 years? We presume it's people on the right telling us this, that in fact we have a liberal press in the United States of America, and it's that liberal press since the time of Vietnam and Watergate that has been running this country down and is responsible for a campaign of disinformation against presumably good-hearted people to the center or the right, politically speaking. Is that the case, that we have a liberal media? Is therefore Fox News fair and balanced? let's talk a little bit about the perception and reality of the press, and maybe even a little more specifically about the role they play in the culture wars. Rob, you want to start us off?
Sure. If you look at numbers, and they're concrete numbers, I don't have them off the top of my head, but I do teach it in the government class, that the media is slightly more liberal, but it's not totally liberal. You have Fox News, you have CNN, you have MSNBC, you have the Sean Hannitys on the right, and you have the Rachel Maddows on the left. But the media, and I think the problem with the media is the word decorum. I mean, they don't know what that is. It's just there's so many media outlets that they're all fighting for the story, and it seems the more brash they've become, the greater they draw that audience. If you listen to talk radio, the statistics there are stunning. I had looked them up prior to the show. 50 million people a day tune into talk radio. Talk radio, I think would be fair to assume, is dominated by the right. So 50 million people going to work and coming home from work are listening to talk radio, which tends to be conservative. Hey, look, I'll be honest with you, I'm a conservative guy, I'm a conservative Republican. But some of the stuff is downright repulsive and is filled with hatred. And you listen to it and you say, well, I can't listen to that. So the media, in its quest to pay its bills, will run stories, will create stories, will embellish, will do whatever. And both sides are guilty of it, whether it's Fox, which is conservative, or CNN, which may be more liberal. They're all. But to say it's dominated totally by the liberal left, the media, is a falsehood. There are conservative outlets on the radio that far outweigh the liberal ones, and so on and so forth. But they do play a role, and the media is good, as I mentioned before. If there's scandals or things going on, we want to know. We're an instant society. What's going on? I want to know. I smell a rat. We want to know. And that goes back in our history as well. But, you know, 200 years ago, it took weeks for news to travel from Washington to a place like New York City or Newburgh, which was on the map. Today, it's instant. And most of it's focusing on negativity. Who said, here's a prime example. When President Obama was in Arizona, and Arizona Governor Jan Brewer pointed the finger. Right. And both sides of the media jumped on that. Well, the conservative side was, well, she was giving him a what for. The liberal side said, well, how dare she? What did they say? Well, no one really knows. But the images now, which now went, quote, viral, were like, oh, you know, ooh, ooh, ooh. And it's that, it's like, you know, being in a high school and a fight breaks out and everybody clamors around the fight. The media has the same mentality. And to me, that's dangerous. But back to the original, is it totally dominated by the liberals? No. There's a pretty fair balance out there, depending on what outlet. I personally like to look at, you know, a diverse selection and then make up my own mind. But not everyone will do that, and I understand that.
Yeah. Rich, thank you. Very nice. Rich Mayfield, in dealing with the local media, and certainly you have contact on a regular basis with them, how do you find the relationship between the local press? Obviously, we don't have as much of it. We're not as saturated with coverage of what's happening in Ed Diana's office or the county legislature or our mayor's offices, but you know the media certainly plays a role. What is it?
I was a press secretary for a number of years, and I think I was a little hard on my friends in the Fourth Estate as a press secretary, and then I decided to string for a local news outlet for a while. So I think part of it was human nature. When you're standing there and there's two or three other reporters and you're trying to get a story and you're trying to get a soundbite and you're trying to get, you know, that shot, something in you takes over and you become very competitive. So partly is human nature, partly is the issues are so complex. I always felt a little bad for our local reporters here. I thought that they struggled mightily to get the story. Usually fell short of what would have been of interest to you as the readers, other than a quick headline, but not for lack of trying. They normally have, some of you may be journalism students, they'll have a storybook and their editors will assign them X number of things and give them X number of hours to churn out so many stories. So they have a very difficult job, and particularly the locals where they're expected. Take, for instance, Times Herald Record. Chris McKenna is our beat reporter. They don't have a Washington bureau anymore. They don't have an Albany bureau anymore. And you've got one guy who's expected to understand the subtleties of, my gentle colleague and I reserve the right to extend and revise my remarks when I sit down for the Congressional Record, and then understand how, the majority leader or a bill gets starred in the state senate, and then figure out what Jeff Berkman, as the minority leader, is trying to talk about, or Ed Diana when he presents a budget. So, do they fall short in giving you what you need to make an informed decision? Yes. Is it for lack of trying? Absolutely not. They try really hard.
Thank you. Ellis, I wanted to start out with you, and then last round, and let's go to the audience. And so, do we have political figures, especially national political figures today, that tend to be more polarizing in their own right? Let's go back to the 1960s, and we have folks like Lyndon Johnson, Richard Nixon, who talked incessantly about bringing the country together, and then by escalating the war in Vietnam and some of the other things Nixon did, only seemed to make so many of the divisions that were so deep in American society by the late 60s and early 70s even worse. Since then, we've had Reagan, who was certainly tremendously respected on the right and among a number of centrists and Democrats who crossed over for the first time. But he, too, a polarizing figure, certainly by the time of the Iran-Contra scandal in the mid-1980s. One only has to say Clinton to have a discussion with any American today who lived through the presidencies of Bill Clinton from 1993 to 2001, who find people that believed he was absolutely one of the best public figures in modern history and was the devil incarnate. I still get this among my students today. Bush was no less polarizing. And now Obama, who presumably wanted to take the high road and be more of a bipartisan statesman, has found himself and his reputation dragged through the mud by both members of his own party who believe he's not progressive enough, and certainly by those on the right who believe that his socialist and communistic tendencies are completely antithetical to the principles of our constitutional democracy. Are we seeing more polarization, do you think, from our political figures? And how do they learn to turn down the rhetoric? What would be strategies that they, or indeed anyone, could use?
I can't believe you're asking me this question. I'll say that I'm not a political scientist or a cultural critic, but I guess I have my own personal opinions, and I'd love to hear, we get to hear your guys' opinions. But my opinion basically is that it's a structural problem. It's, Obama, no matter how much he wants to do good by people, I think, unfortunately, this is, it's going to be hard for him. It's going to be hard for anybody. I am a Green Party member. I'm not a Democrat. I, 1984, when I first did my little card at Bronx Science to vote, I signed up as a Democrat, and I think it was, I don't know how many years ago, I decided to be a Green Party member and vote on the Green ticket. I voted for my friend Jason West, who is, I think, the first Green mayor in New York. He ran twice, and he's now our mayor. But again, I keep forgetting my points here. But basically, I think that it comes down to, it's just a very difficult thing. And I think he has a tough, I feel bad for him. I think that he, a lot of people that I know don't feel bad for him. A lot of people I know, who are on the left, who are liberals, are just sick of him and they're angry at him. And it must be my empathy, because I actually don't feel so angry at him, because I have an understanding of he's in a tough spot. And I think it has to do with the structure of what we've got, the structure, the economic and political structure. And I don't have an answer.
Well, let me ask, turn to the two gentlemen, fellas. Does it make sense to pine for the days of great statesmen We look at the Lincolns and Washingtons as figures that somehow, I don't know if this is true, but we saw them as great men that were equal to the great times that they went through. And the argument is that today in politics, where are the great leaders, the great men, the great women? And they are not only not there, but the figures that are there are polarizing the situation further because they are not true national leaders, but they are leaders of their party and their ideology alone, and that too is contributing to the culture wars. Ron, is there truth to that? Or
I think so. We often say, where are the statesmen or the stateswomen? And when we say that, we refer to someone as being a statesman or a stateswoman, that they'll do the right thing. You know, I'm going to be elected to office to do the right thing. And, you know, the old saying is many a man and now a woman have gone to Washington with the idea that they're going to change it, like President Obama, and then getting there and saying, my God, there's no way I can change this. Ronald Reagan is often referred to as a great communicator, and Republicans like to refer to him. He was no real conservative when you get down to it and you start to look at it. But he did win quite handily in 1980 and then again in 1984, taking the Northeast, which tends to be more leaning towards the liberal side, and he did win. So what did he do and how did he do it? Bill Clinton also had done the same thing and got those in the middle to vote for him twice, was reelected because they went more towards the center. But we see now, and in my opinion, when President Obama, I think Barack Obama is a guy I'd like to meet personally and shake his hand. I think he's a good guy. He's an intelligent man. He has a beautiful wife, two beautiful kids. And you look at him and say, wow, you know, there's a nice role model for our country and for people to look at and say, well, here's a guy, you know, that broke the color barrier. Yet there are those that still will criticize him for, you know, the color of his skin or his philosophy. But he came in with great hope. But then, you know, as Paul had just mentioned, it kind of veered too far to the left, and maybe the people surrounding him pulled him too far to the left. So that hope and change kind of got lost in that because the political party pulled him one way. That forced the polarization on the other side with the conservatives. So you look at this, and really, you know, 25% of the nation is really Democrat, 25% is Republican, but the fat of the order, 50% is undecided. They're in the middle. So a candidate has to be very, very careful. So now we have Rick Santorum vaulting to the front, but you're going to see his numbers start to slide here, mark my words, with him, because he might be appeasing the real hard-right conservatives, but America is not a hard-right conservative nation, nor is it a hard-left conservative nation. There's so many people right in the middle, and they're looking for, they're just dying for a candidate or candidates, male, female, black, white, gay, lesbian, who's going to do the right thing? Mm-hmm. And we're not seeing that.
Mm-hmm. Let's. I've promised an hour of the panel, and we delivered that. Can we give them a hand, too? It's not easy for them to do. I think they've done very well thus far. Please, now to you, the audience, for comments or questions to us.
Well, I think, Rob, you may just have alluded to this, but we've been talking around it. When you talk about our evolutionary attitudes, it seems to me that one of the things that most of us are born with is suspicion of people are different. And one of the things that a lot of people, not everybody, but a lot of people dislike about Barack Obama is that he's black. It's racism. We should talk about that. You know, and of course, it's not politically acceptable to these days for the Republican presidential candidates to, you know, to say, don't vote for him because he's black. But boy, that's a deep well of resentment against Barack Obama. And just one other thing,
yeah.
If you look at early presidential elections, and I'm sure we're all familiar with Jefferson, the things they said,
oh, yeah.
I mean,
pretty nasty.
You wouldn't, I think they would hesitate to say anything like those things about a presidential candidate today. Mm-hmm. So this idea of, and the press, of course, you didn't have a press that pretended to be impartial. You had a Federalist press and a an anti-federalist press, and they said anything. Now, there was no depth to which they wouldn't sink in terms of castigating their opponent. John Adams was trying to turn the country back to the British, and Washington had to threaten him with death to prevent him to do it. And Jefferson was an atheist who was going to bring, you know, prostitutes to the White House and all this kind of stuff. I wonder how much worse.
So on a positive note, yeah,
interesting guy.
We have seen some progress, at least in professionalization.
It isn't any worse, perhaps, now than it was. It's faster. I mean, you said you get it more quickly now, but
yeah. Wasn't. Can I just respond, Henry, real quick?
Sure. Yeah.
Couple things, Henry. You know, with Barack Obama, he really is—he's the first biracial president.
Yes.
I mean, if we want to be
correct,
he's half white and half black.
No one.
However, we can call him African American. For him to be elected, obviously a lot of white people had to vote for him.
Yep.
That's a good thing. And I think that's a positive thing for our nation. And I often tell people that, say, listen, whether you like him or not, but yeah, there's still racism in our country. We know that. When John F. Kennedy ran, it was an anti-Catholic. You know, we don't want a Catholic in there. The Pope's going to control the country. So, yeah. And presidents have always been attacked. Henry, you're a history man. But have they been attacked to the volume that these last few presidents have been attacked?
Well, the volume is linked to technology.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah,
exactly.
I think the volume is...
I mean, they're under the microscope. I mean, Barack Obama, you know, has gas and it's on the evening news.
But the virulence of the attacks
is not
pretty serious.
That's the incivility.
Yeah.
Mike?
Yeah, I'd like us to maybe go back to, and you raised the book up, Hunter's book there.
Yeah.
Go back to the definition of what we mean by culture wars. And it's a clash between two moral visions in a public sphere.
Mm-hmm.
And we keep kind of bouncing around that topic, the public sphere, whether it's the technological public sphere, whether it's the print media public sphere, but the way a public sphere works, it's not just that they put information out there, they're putting information out to an audience that's supposed to be educated, involved, and thoughtful. That's how a democratic public sphere works. I would suggest it's not necessarily the media's problem so much as the public's problem, that it sort of goes back to Rich's claim that you get the media you deserve. You're getting, if no one's complaining, or if people are not educated enough or thoughtful enough about what they're receiving, you're not going to get the public sphere that responds to this saying, this isn't the information we want, ergo, this isn't the type of candidate we want.
Right.
I think that we're looking at this the wrong way. We're trying to vilify one group or vilify a specific, the fourth estate, as you put it, instead of looking at the deeper, more maybe intrinsic problems in America, that we've always aimed at building a civil society. We've always, since the 1780s, aimed at creating this sort of perfect place where everyone's a virtuous member of participating in society and politics, but we failed miserably in large part because of our lack of education and our lack of involvement. And we've, you know, pawned it off on others. Oh, well, they're smarter, they know what they're doing. And then when it comes back to bite us in the rear end, then we complain. But we also at the same time line up like pigs at the trough for whether, you know, President Obama has gas or not.
Right.
That we've come to accept that as what we call news.
Right.
As a public, we need to demand more.
Demand more, and we need more reasoned and reasonable public discourse. And that means education, it means an understanding and awareness of the issues, and not at the most superficial of levels, but at some deeper level that can then feed that information back into the kinds of choices we make when we pick a presidential candidate or whatever we do.
As long as, though, the sort of quote-unquote red meat sells, as
mm-hmm.
long as there are people lining up to take it
mm-hmm.
on both sides of the aisle.
That's what you're going to get.
That's what you're going to get. And
Jersey Shore is the number one show. Why is it? That's what people want. So
I don't know. I haven't watched television in 9 years. So
now maybe my audience is self-selecting, though, Mike. But whenever I hear that, and then I sit around with a group of Americans like this, I assume most of us in the room and you are citizens, and we have these conversations, they often strike me as reasonable and thoughtful, and good arguments are put forward. Now again, maybe it's because they're academic settings, and people tend to follow the issues more carefully and have more concern for public discourse and how we talk about these things and their importance to our lives, but...
Well, just not to hog things, but which I'm doing, but go back to a report in the New York Times the other week. It was a Sunday, not this past week, but the week before, where they looked at the reddest states in the union, the places that are most vehemently against the idea of entitlement programs, are receiving the vast majority of entitlement programs. The very people who complain about these things are the ones receiving it, though they're not necessarily aware or educated in the political arena or in the sort of terminology to understand what's going on.
Yeah.
That there's a deep disconnect or maybe even a dissonance operating in this United States about what it is we're trying to do, what it is we aim at, and the deepest problem is one driven by an economic system that encourages us in television, in media, in every other way, to look out for number one and ignore the group. Mm-hmm. And I think that Alice was dead on with the idea of the group and trying to figure out how to service the group.
But one thing, Paul, if I just throw out,
sure.
Every person sitting in this room, it's so important that you recognize that your power and voice has a great deal of weight. If you are dissatisfied with the story, and I've lived it for many years, where people would read a story or listen to a television report, and they would call the station, they would get in touch with the producer. It takes a little effort on your part, but if you demand better coverage, you will get it. When you're reading through a paper and you see a story after, and you think, my gosh, they beat that story to death, more than likely it's because they've gotten feedback from you, the customer, that you happen to be interested in whatever that story is. And oftentimes I used to get calls from reporters and they would say, you know, I got this little old lady from Tuxedo Park and she called and she, you know, chewed my ear off for 30 minutes, but I never thought to ask you this. And it would spin off into another story. So as the consumer, please, if you leave this room with anything else, you have an enormous amount of power to affect change, not only in your government, your community, and your news people all across this country. Just use it.
Great.
We the people, look at
great
that
message.
Tie right there.
Yeah.
And it fell in the front row.
Yeah.
It comes up.
I just wondered whether the Occupy movement was actually an embodiment of this, and if that's sort of the direction we're going in. It feels like that to me. I know that the winter came and things sort of got sluggish, but there was this huge momentum and this great passion, and then, you know, I know, but I wonder if, in fact, that's what...
An expression of the enormous dissatisfaction, maybe, of the two major parties' inability to seriously deal with the problems that in the fundamental problem of income inequality in the United States today. Or maybe it was what Rob is saying, that 50% of us do not strongly identify with the Republican or Democratic parties today, and something else has to emerge to, whether it's a third party movement or an Occupy Wall Street movement or whatever it happens to be. So I think to some extent that explains the rise of these social movements that many Americans are convinced, rightly or wrongly, that our two-party system, do I sound like Ralph Nader now, is not all wise and all good, but in fact needs to be pushed from these other sources in order to either step aside or lead, to use the famous phrase. We haven't heard from a student, I don't think, yet, Rob? Yeah.
Yeah, Mr. Sassy, you mentioned that the culture wars are kind of turning a lot of people off to politics. And I couldn't help but think that it's also turning certain types of people on.
Oh, yeah.
And those are the fringe groups.
Mm-hmm.
And when the fringe groups get involved, nothing good ever typically comes of it. So do you think that the culture war, that the end result is naturally some sort of violence or strife that's going to happen from those ends of the spectrum, and is it on purpose?
Well, I think you're seeing it. You're right on. The fringe groups are popping up on the left and the right. However you want to classify the Occupy people in different parts of the country or the religious right, they will pop up. And the fringe groups, again, it's the same thing. If they're the ones, you know, the squeaky wheel gets the oil, if half the population is just like, I've had it, I'm not interested, and those fringe groups now start to gain momentum. The Tea Party, you look at that, that's a fringe group that came up, but they gained a little momentum now that, you know, the wind is kind of out of their sails. If you've studied politics and history, you know that parties like that come and go. They're what we call a flash in the pan. They're here and they're gone the next day. But you're right, they can be very dangerous if they gain traction. But on the same token, if they do gain traction, what does that tell you about the population, the public? If they're, you know, if this Occupy thing took off, there's more than a few people that, that feel that way about Wall Street and our financial system. So, you know.
Just a way to grow it out of that.
Sure, good question.
Yeah, please.
I think part of the problem with people not wanting to be involved in politics is two things. One, politicians these days, thanks to the media and thanks to, you know, the widespread consumption of, you know, social media and stuff like that, the politicians have become celebrities, you know, and as celebrities, we see all these reality TV shows like the Kardashians, stuff. Every aspect of their lives is picked apart, and that's news,
right.
And that's become the same way with politicians. And I think a lot of people don't want to be involved. They don't want their lives picked apart like that, so that it scares them off. Not only that, if they can get over that aspect of it, you got the aspect of politics where it is a two-party system. You have the Democrats and the Republicans, right? And they have, you know, fairly specific agendas, and to regardless of what your own personal, you know, agenda is, you're gonna, if you get involved in politics, in order to get anywhere, you know, 95, 98%, you got to be a Republican or a Democrat, and your agenda is gonna get just lost in the wash, kind of, and you're gonna have to get focused there. And I think that's part of what happened with President Obama. He had his agenda, you know, he ran on that, and then he got in there, and his, you know, in order to get anything done, he had to side with the Democrats because you got the Republicans fighting him in Congress. Mm-hmm. And it's just until that system can somehow be shaken up to where an agenda actually can be an agenda that, you know, for the man you voted for rather than the party, the establishment that is already in place, it's going to be
the,
you know,
genius,
the same
thing. Of American politics. You make a great point, is compromise.
Right.
And from the very inception of the nation, the Connecticut Compromise, which created the United States Congress, through Missouri in 1820, 1850, and beyond, we always seem to pull our fat out of the fire at the last moment because somebody on the left and the right was willing to say, but the public good and the greater good must come first, must come above party or my self-interest or my desire to be heard or be a celebrity or whatever it happens to be. Have Americans in our political system lost the ability to compromise, or do you think that it's still possible to build that consensus and find that a common ground today? Because without it, you think, you know, at some level we have to be doomed. Yeah.
I think on that point, when you looked after 9/11, you know, when you saw some measure of bipartisanship, and it comes down to survival. On a general everyday basis, the Republicans are trying to remain in power, they're trying to survive, the Democrats are trying to remain in power, trying to survive. And it's not until a tragedy that affects both sides that you see bipartisanship, and that's when things actually get done. But it's a culture these days. It's everything short-term memory.
Yeah.
You know, you only remember what happened recently. That, you know, things get too far behind, you get back to the same old ways. You get
and
back
we know
to trying to survive.
That it wasn't long before that goodwill between Republicans and Democrats quickly
mm-hmm.
broke down and brought us back to the same impasse we're in now. I saw a hand over there. Yeah.
Two questions. What are the implications of a relatively ignorant and unsophisticated electorate who knows far more about American Idol and what's on television every night than the Supreme Court or the legislative process? And two, we have danced around the whole issue of money. Is it possible for any one but one of the two main parties to run in the absence of millions and millions and millions of dollars? They're talking, President Obama is going to, and this is just a figure they throw out there, is going to spend $1 billion.
Right. And then the super PACs, which is money that's not even, presumably not even directly affiliated with the major parties or the candidates, and we expect that hundreds of millions of dollars will be spent there because of the Citizens United decision by the end of the general election this November. Good Lord. Let's start with the first question, because those are two very good questions. Do we live in the age of the unsophisticated electorate, Rich Mayfield? Are you convinced that no offense, that the masses are asses and that the people often don't know what they're talking about, that they don't care enough about the political processes and the effect they have on their lives, but simply care more about the Jersey Shores and the Kardashians of the world. I have not seen either show, by the way, so I plead ignorance on both those counts.
I would suggest that democracies are great and wonderful institutions that stumble along until some great crisis confronts them, and then somehow we pull it together and perform a miracle. Pearl Harbor, World War II. I don't think the American people are ignorant. I think that the political leaders may not always have the highest regard for their opinions, and sometimes it's much easier just to assume that, well, we have some nebulous idea, well, lower taxes and make sure the roads are running. But I think there's a lot more to it than that. What it takes is an incredible amount of effort to reach into the citizenry and see what exactly is on their mind. And you would think it would be much easier with social media and all that stuff, but
polling,
and although there's changing desire, changing realm with polling, but so long-winded answer, and yes and no are valid answers in politics. You might be stunned to learn that, but they are. Little long-winded, but no, I think there's an enormous energy within the American people, and I believe that our greatest contribution to the world is an ability to rise above these things and come to an American solution where we realize as a people that the things that divide us are never as great as those things that ultimately unite us.
Well put. And on the second question quickly, as far as money and politics, if Rob or Alice want to jump in on that one. Has it gotten to the point where so much of the culture wars is irrelevant because it all comes down to the almighty dollar anyway, and he laughs last who is best funded in the end?
It is interesting. I mean, it's very rare that an underdog that is poorly funded can pull off a major victory. Chris Christie did it against John Corzine in New Jersey as governor. That's the most recent one I can think of. But money plays a role, unfortunately. And the money and tying into his first question as well, historians in the room know our founding fathers never intended the masses to vote. They didn't want them to because they felt they were ignorant and they had no vested interest. So when we get 50% voter turnout, say this November, we consider that good. Some would argue it's excellent because the people that really have a vested interest have voted. The other half, are not interested, and that's okay. It's two sides of the story. But the money definitely plays a role. When you hear a Nevada billionaire has already written out checks to Newt Gingrich, millions of dollars
through a super PAC.
And you say, wow, and President Obama's going to raise $1 billion. Well, a billion isn't what it used to be, but still, it's a significant amount of money. If I were running for president, I'd like to have $1 billion.
Still $1,000 million,
that's right.
Anyway, you
so
got
it's
it.
A lot of money. So, as I watch that with the money, I think of all those television stations and networks as just cashing in on all this.
Alice, you're a social activist. I guess you self-style yourself in that way. Why, in an age where we see more apathy and arguably, and we're arguing over this, perhaps a less sophisticated electorate, you have chosen personally to involve yourself and engage yourself in community issues? What does that say about you and the kind of person you are and other people who choose that path as opposed to perhaps the millions who don't? And how do we energize those people and make them see that they have to take, at some level, responsibility for social and political change in their own lives and not merely leave it up to, no offense, gentlemen, but the talking heads in government and in the media?
Well, you put me on a spot to talk about myself because I've already done it a million times already and I feel like it. But I think that there are certain traits. I know that I was very passionate about pesticides when I first started to learn about them. When my daughter's dad was diagnosed with cancer, I walked around my neighborhood and I saw all these little yellow signs that said pesticides, you know, whatever. And I thought, I wonder if this has been contributing to all the cancer. Three people I had found out in like a matter of 2 weeks were diagnosed with cancer. So I started reading about it, and lo and behold, it turns out, yes, indeed, lawn care pesticides are contributing to things like cancer and asthma and immune system disorders and autism and you name it. And that's a liberal conservative thing because, in fact, I mean, we don't have much time for me to go through this, but you know, what concerns me about conservatives on these kinds of environmental questions is it always appears that they're sort of short-sighted and for profit. They're not, you know, and this is no offense to conservatives because I think, you know, they offer a lot. But in these kinds of questions, for me, it feels like they're being short-sighted. So for me, I felt passionate. I had a sort of, same thing with Fukushima. When I found out about Fukushima, I was devastated by that. I took it to heart. And I was at the end of a semester, and I decided to protest. And I organized a huge protest in New Paltz, 150 people on a highway holding hands and protesting to shut down Indian Point, which is, I don't know how far from here, it's about 50 miles from New Paltz. And it's a big mess, we don't have time to talk about it, but it's close to here as well. And you know, I think that in psychology, there's a construct in personality theory. It's five different constructs. There's openness, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. And all people, according to personality theorists, fall within this continuum of these things. So some people are more conscientious than other people, and you can be, you know, score a 20 or 80. Some people are more extroverted than other people. Some people are more agreeable than other people. These are things that are probably native to us when we're born. I believe that we're not blank slates. We come out with various kinds of things, and we're like flowers, you know, we all look different. And so I think that your question to me about what is it about, yeah. I have certain elements to, you know, but I think that we all have within us, I truly believe, you know, passion and care for others. And I think that that's really, for me, this whole issue is how to sort of tap into the care that we all have, the empathy that we all have to move. And I think in terms of evolution and evolutionary psychology, you know, when people feel anxious, do you ever feel anxious? I believe that we have emotions, and evolutionary psychologists believe that we have emotions for a reason. Emotions evolved to make you move, from the Greek word mover, to move. So when I felt anxious after Fukushima, that anxiety, I didn't know what to do with that anxiety. That anxiety led me to move. And perhaps we wouldn't be so anxious in this country, we wouldn't have to take Prozac and SSRIs, if instead of, you know, medicating ourselves, we actually listened and to the feelings that we have and moved on them, you know, in terms of action. And that's the activist in me. So.
Well, that's a hopeful message, and I did want to end on a hopeful note tonight. Okay. So I think that's an appropriate place for us to finish up. So why don't we end it there? But come up and see us. We'll be here for a few minutes. Help me again thank our panelists, and I want to thank all of you for coming out. Remember, visit our SUNYOrange.edu website, and you'll see that we will be back here next Wednesday for the FDR Presidency at 7 p.m. And we have Bob Clark coming from the Presidential Library and Museum, and some great panelists for that night of fun as well. Thanks, everybody, for coming out.